Hi, how does it feel when someone you like on Tinder likes you back? Great, isn't it? Especially with guys, does it happen that the first person you like likes you back? Second, third, thousandth, millionth? God knows what's that number. But then, don't you figure out how to crack the system? What kind of person will like you back and what kind of person will not like you? Isn't it? How do you do that? How do you come to that conclusion? There are multiple data points of past and of expectations. And then you make the decision. You understand the scenario. Have you learned cycling or swimming? Isn't it a great feeling to swim or cycle once you have learned it? It's fun, isn't it? But was it easy to learn it? Initially, you had no idea how to balance yourself, how to keep yourself afloat. People tell you, oh, keep your legs straight, don't bend it, only then you'll be able to float it. But then you forget it. But then you practice. And then you realize, oh yeah, it does help me. Oh, this trick works better. Oh, that's how I have to balance myself in the cycle, or I'll fall down. There are multiple negative rewards of falling. And then there's the ultimate positive reward. And in between, small positive rewards when you balance yourself for 10 meter, 20 meter, and so on and so forth. What are you doing over here? In your mind, subconsciously, you're gathering multiple data and then connecting those dots and figuring out how to bicycle, how to swim. That's how one learns anything, isn't it? So this is how decisions are made. You know, this is what a data scientist is, who makes decisions based on multiple data, depending on what positive rewards are and what the negative rewards are. Companies, like individuals, have to make decisions to survive in the market, to optimize their existence, to optimize their revenue, their profit. And hence, they have to have data scientists to help them make those decisions, to get those actionable insights. Pause the video for a moment and think, what kind of decisions do companies make? What kind of companies can you think of? What are those companies which are new? What kind of decisions they make? What are the companies that are old, which have always existed, much before you were born? What kind of decisions are they making? What kind of data they need? What kind of decision they make is helped by the data that they have? What kind of companies did you think of? What are the old companies, such as the oil companies, the railways? What are the new companies, like Netflix, Amazon, Quora, Facebook, YouTube, and of course, our Tinder? Did you hear of the news recently? The Saudi oil company Aramco, there was an attack on its oil fields. It was a big thing. 5% of world's crude oil production just came down. They have to re-optimize everything. What do? They produce oil. They transport it from one place to another, from the crude oil to the refinery, the various parts, the petrol, diesel, the aircraft fuel, kerosene, wax, and they have to transport it to different customers across the world, from America to Australia, from China to Chile. How do they do it? They have to get it to the port. They have certain vehicles. So they have to follow something called the vehicle routing problem. I have multiple tankers which have certain capacity. My manufacturing is happening somewhere. My ports are somewhere. I have to get these from here to there. The tankers are there. And there are multiple ports with multiple demands, different demands, and multiple supply points. What happens after that? Then it moves to different companies. Then companies like Maersk come in. It's also a very old company. They have to ship goods from one place to another. They have to decide what capacity ship to keep in which location. Call it vehicle routing problem, call it traveling salesman problem, the capacity problem, the knapsack problem. These are all operations research problem. They also have to figure out, you know, if the good is perishable, if they are transporting vegetables or fruits from one place to another. They have to do it in stipulated time. There's a cost involved. There's a lot of data involved, how to make those decisions. What about the new age companies? How does Netflix decide which is the show that you would like? You keep watching certain shows. There are people who watch similar shows and they have liked certain kind of shows. Would you also like that show, or you won't like it? If you're on Amazon, what kind of clothes will you buy? Will those clothes look good on you? the clothes that you like or the clothes that people like on you, like your Instagram photos. How does Instagram figure out what things you would like to follow, what information you would like to know? These are all data science questions. In this new age, things have evolved. The data science has become an extremely important field for business to survive. Was it always the case? Yeah, the answer is no. But why not? What is it new that has come which was not before? Is it just the new age company or our way of looking at the problems? Are we looking at things differently which we could not do earlier? Were there not smart people before? There was Newton, there was Galileo, there was Einstein. What is there in data science which was not there before and has come in? Give it a try. What are the components of data science? Business, you know, company like Shell has existed long before this data science came into existence. Were they not doing it before? You as an individual don't do it before? What has changed? Give the video a pause again and think. There are different aspects of data science. There is statistics, machine learning, the whole business understanding, deep learning, you know, lots of data, visualization. You know, these are the words you keep hearing here and there and everywhere. But what has changed really are two things. One, the computational power. Two, the cheapness of storing the data. There was airline industry which was very common after World War II, starting 1950s. But now, those same airline companies can store all the data of each flight, of every sensor on the flight. There are thousands of sensors on each of the flight, and there are thousands, millions of aircraft flying above at any point of time. And all that data is stored, not just for that moment, but for months and months and months behind. Suppose that you are manager of a railroad company, a train system, which transports goods from the East Coast, somewhere near New York, to the West Coast, towards California. You transport a lot of shipment. What is priority for you? That delivery should happen on time. Which is the biggest risk that you have? That the trains derail. There's a crack on the railways. So you keep auditing those tracks, that there's no crack and the trains do not have to stop. There are no problems in transporting the goods. But if you keep auditing the tracks very often, then that would delay the trains, that would cost you. If you audit it after too much gap, then cracks may develop and there may be train accidents. So you have to optimize that. How do you do that? You collect lots and lots and lots of data of past, when accidents happen, when did not happen. A zero, no accident, a very few ones, accidents did happen, and you have to prevent them. You have, you know, billions of rows of data and thousands of columns. How many trains have passed through? What was the weight of those trains? How fast the trains were traveling? What were the weather conditions? What was the temperature? Each hour, each minute, each second, the temperature you have recorded it. And then you see with a concept, a simple statistical concept like logistic regression. Oh, if these conditions are met, the cracks may develop and accidents may happen. If these are not happening, then certainly no accidents are happening. And there is a gray region in between where you optimize your surveillance and you improve your business, you minimize your cost. How could you do it? There were railroad companies before as well. They were not able to do it. But now you can do it because you can store terabytes of data at a very cheap cost and do computation of them very fast and very easily. We will ask three questions now. First, what is a data scientist? Second, who should become a data scientist? Third, how to become a data scientist? Let's start with the first one. What is a data scientist? What do you think? It's a very simple answer. Data scientist is a person who helps the business answer relevant questions. They help the business get actionable insights, which helps the business grow, increase its revenue, minimize its cost, optimize its profit. How do they do it? They do it using data. Many people confuse data scientist as being someone who learns a lot of statistics, machine learning, is a geek and this and that. It's the end that defines the means and not the other way around. What are the problems that we are solving? What are we doing? A data scientist answers business questions. Not only that, he helps business ask questions. Or she uses data in such a way that the data makes you ask questions or gives you insights. Oh, is it? I never thought so. Let me give an example. How does Apple decide when to launch a new model? You know, if it launches too soon, it will cannibalize the sales of its previous model. If it launches too late, then Samsung or Nokia or Motorola would come up with a new model and eat away Apple's market. So they have to optimize it. In some cases, it can be a simple trend line, which shows that, you know, my sales of the previous models is still increasing. And this is not a point to launch a new model. Or it has become flat. I'm still going to get business. This is not a point to launch a new model. Or it's coming down. Maybe, you know, when it starts coming down or when it reaches a certain point. But is that only so? No. You have to see Samsung. You have to see Motorola. What are they doing? After how much gap do they usually launch a new model? Oh, my sales are going up, but there's a very high likelihood that Nokia is going to launch a new model. And before they launch it, I have to launch a new one. This, you know, can be done just using visualization. Though it's not as simple as it sounds like, but there are many business problems that are solved like that. So this is who a data scientist is. So what was the second question? Yeah, it was, who should become a data scientist? What do you think? My answer would be a person who wants to make sense of the world around himself or herself should become a data scientist. Pick up the data from a store or across all the stores of Walmart and see what things people buy together, depending on their age, depending on their gender, you know. On Friday, people buy nappies and beer together. Why does that happen? Would you have ever thought that? Data threw it out for you by a simple concept called market basket analysis. Or what is the buying pattern different based on the gender? You know, is it so that females in America and females in China have the same buying pattern as compared to men from China and America? Or is it different? You know, these things happen. Data throws you all this. As a data scientist, these are the interesting things that you would come to know. And then you'll have your aha moment. Oh, I see. I never thought that. That was so counterintuitive. But once you realize it, wow, that was fun. That was amazing. Let me meet a friend and talk to him about it. Or our friends. Or let me put a YouTube video on it. You know, life is very exciting as a data scientist. It's not just mundane work of coding. You know, many people like coding. It's not mundane for most of the people, but for some it is. But then all the things doesn't matter whether I'll be able to code, whether I'll be able to understand statistics or not. No, once you find that interest, you know, which everyone finds to make sense of the world around themselves, then all these things would become trivial. And for these, you know, there are tons of people there to help you, like me and our company, and we'll do that. So that brings us to the final question, the third question. How to become a data scientist? You know, this is a very fast evolving space. There are multiple aspects. New things come, old things go, technologies come and go. But the overarching thing that you have to understand is to make sense of things, to get an idea. And no one can know all the things. Different people know different things and people work together and understand. You can be a visualization expert. You can be an ETL expert. You can be a machine learning, deep learning, reinforcement learning expert. Or you may just know how to code. As long as you are keen to understand, trying to figure out, things would happen. So certain basic things are there. Like if you want to go the coding way and if you don't have much of an experience, then R is a very good language to pick up. There's a very good language called Python as well. There's certain analysis that can be done in SQL as well, or in Excel as well. arranging the data, pivoting them, taking month-wise data like this and, you know, just holding their ear and turning them around, turning them like this, slicing, dicing, putting graphs. Does it require a line graph? The import of United States of America based on the continents. That would not require a line graph, that would require a pie chart. Simple visualization ideas, and then how to do it in Matplotlib in Python, or ggplot in R, or in any other, or in Tableau, you know. So these things are there. Then the most important thing is understanding the business. What business wants, what kind of questions they are asking, what insights that they are looking for, how to model them. Suppose you're running a hospital. So how to understand the distribution of arrival of people. It can be Poisson distribution. And then figuring out how much time it takes for a person's x-ray to happen. That can be uniform distribution. How much time does a doctor spend with a person? That can be exponential distribution. Basic small statistics concept, which if taught properly, can be very easily understood. So there is programming, there is statistics, there is business modeling, and of course, the whole data engineering aspect of storing the data, in what format to store it, so that the retrieval is easy. Whether I should use Hadoop or Spark, what is MapReduce? So these are the different things that a data scientist can know. And keep in mind, one does not have to know everything. You don't have to think, oh my God, so much to study, how would I do it? You know, I'll have to learn everything. That would take me ages. No, it doesn't happen like that. 6 months is good enough to know a lot of things, and you can start, you know, by a programming language immediately, or by learning statistics immediately. No one in this industry knows everything. They work with each other. They have a little idea of what the others are doing. They can, with time, pick up what others are doing, bits and pieces of it. But then, you know, no one has to do everything, so you don't have to worry about it. And if there's even a small bit of worry how to understand thing, then we are over here to help you learn it. You choose which one you want. You want to start with Python, you want to start with statistics, or you want us to help you decide where to start, how to package it. We are there for you. We at Lecteron have committed data scientists from different industrial background, with different knowledge, with different academic backgrounds. Some are PhDs, some are masters in statistics, some are masters in programming, some are PhD in computer science. And based on their experience, some work in academics, some keep evolving different algorithm for business, and based on their experience and knowledge, we have created bit-sized courses for you. And we have tested them. Lecteron does testing at its own campus and tries to figure out whether which is the best way people are learning. And we also figure out that different people have different learning style. So we have created those courses, different aspects, different styles, different modules, so that your learning is most easy and most impactful. We have multiple tests, certifications to keep you on your toes and keep learning as fast as possible and as much as possible. Let's all learn together and everyone be more knowledgeable. Hey, my phone is buzzing. Gosh, my wife's message. She's asking whether I'm on Tinder. I was just joking, I'm not there on Tinder. Got to go. Hey, don't forget to subscribe the channel below. See ya, bye-bye.